Yeah, we got to get right back into this. It's the Opie and Anthony Show. In studio, Jeffrey Ross and Ken Burns.
Yes. No, you don't have headphones? Why would you?
He can't hear. Ken Burns cannot hear.
Ken Burns can't hear. Are you insane?
I got music and no voices.
Oh, the music? No voices?
All
right. Is that better?
I'll turn down the music then. How's that?
Nothing?
Nothing.
Why?
Oh, we're looking stupid in front of Ken Burns.
No.
He's going to do a documentary on awful radio shows next.
Yeah, right. We'll be prominently featured. Yeah, ears.
Oh, my God.
Comes in and points to the ears. No.
Oh,
you don't have to fix his iPhones.
Oh,
what are you doing?
If it's a comedian or an actor, who cares? But it's a documentary filmmaker.
This guy's a respected documentary filmmaker. Yeah, that's cool. It. There we go. Okay. Ken Burns. The War... I watched it. Fantastic. When I heard your name attached to it, I was like, this is great. The Civil War was amazing. I know people have, over the years just given you much praise on that.
What amazed me about the Civil War documentary is how well spoken these people were. The letters were, "My dear Penelope, I hope this letter finds you in good health." And it's like, Who the hell wrote like that?
Well, it was, they said about the Civil War, it was a war between the two most literate armies ever to fight.
Mm-hmm.
And the whole idea, when you didn't have the internet, when you didn't have TV, didn't have radio, you didn't have
Xbox
anything.
Xbox and all these distractions.
You learned how to write, and it became important how you represented yourself, just as how we represent ourselves in the way we dress, the music we listen to, some of the habits that we have. It's no different. It's just in that day and age, it was focused entirely on expression.
Right.
Writing.
Because the letters would come out and they'd talk about this death and destruction of so many people so eloquently and make these analogies that are just beautiful and brilliant.
But it's interesting. We just did a thing a month or two ago in Washington, D.C., where we had one of our guys, the fighter pilot. We had a Vietnam vet who'd seen lots of combat, and we'd seen an Iraqi war veteran just back. And as they were talking, you felt like you were watching the grandson, the father, and the grandfather. I mean, they were the same person. And at one point, the World War II guy, our guy, says, "I haven't told my son this." And the son was out in the audience, and he begins to tear up. He said, "I go to a Redskin game, every home game for the last 50 years. And when the Star Spangled Banner is playing before the game, I just go through in my mind the faces of all my buddies that I
lost." Wow.
And he starts to cry. And the Iraqi guy says, "I feel like I'm an echo of you and you're an echo of me." It's the same thing. And when you see some of the letters that come back, they're now emails, and moms will always, for as long as they're emails, press print, right?
Oh, and save
on these things and save them. They have that articulation. They don't maybe use the same flourish of language that you do back in the Civil War. But some of the letters, as you know, that we got back from World War II, guys, are the same thing. So the impulse is the same. You just want to stay alive, keep your buddies alive, and just figure out some way to deal with this horror that war is.
Do you find it surprising that – because it's one thing I find surprising – but then after you think about it for a while, I guess not. A lot of these old vets from World War II, that emotion is still there and comes out so easily. They can remember the faces of the friends that have died and how they died and the detail. And they just break down a lot of times, and it's heartbreaking. It's just wrenching to watch.
This is the key. Like, we live in this consumer moment, and we're all focused on now. If I just wear the right jeans or drive the right car or smell the right, everything will be all right. But memory is not something that's 60 years ago. Memory is something on your hard drive now. So these guys might start off to answer a question that we ask and not know that by the end of it, they'll have access that and be in tears
because just hits
them, it's always right there. And there's a guy who's lived a good life, he's not cuckoo, and his hand shakes almost every morning from remembering that time 63 years ago when he's mowing down Germans and cutting them in half and watching bodies fly in half from his fighter plane. I mean, this is the reality of war, and when you access that, not interested in all that other junk, the context or the just what it was like to be in battle, then you have an opportunity to sort of be present. But then you have to ask yourself, how does this happen? One thing is, it was shared sacrifice. It's a paradox. In shared sacrifice, we made ourselves richer. Today, we're all independent free agents. We walk around. We're not going to give up anything. And yet, we feel that poverty. You know, we have a war going on, but it's fought by a professional class that does all its suffering alone and apart from the rest of us. We're told at 9/11 that the threat was as great as Hitler, but nobody asked us to do anything. They said, go shopping. I mean, if my president had said to me, here are 50 things I need you to give up or to do, everybody in the country would have done that.
Right.
And who knows where we'd be right now. We may not have $3.50 oil, gas. We may not have our bridges and our levees fail.
There were huge sacrifices made during World War II, and people got involved on the civilian front.
And it made us richer. That's the paradox. Not just spiritually richer, we're all together on this, we're all in the same boat, but materially, financially richer. We started off this impoverished country, reeling from the Depression, and 4 years later, we're the richest country on Earth, and more than half the manufacturing in the entire world is taking place right here.
Do you find
that? We form really wonderful relationships in a job like this, in college, in sports, you know, intense relationships with siblings and with parents. But the bonds that you forge in basic training and then in combat are unlike anything else. I mean, the experience of war is, it's a paradox, because when your life is most threatened, you live life at its height. And then you see things and experience things no human being should have to experience. And then you come home and you actually can't tell mom. You can't tell pop. You can't tell your brother. You can't tell your best friend. You left your best friend's arm and body over there.
Yeah.
So you lock it away in the safest, deepest resources of your psyche. But then later on, you do have that impulse. Who can you tell? Who do you speak to? And quite often it's the stranger. I mean, we'd find these guys, we talk to more than 600 people to get the 40 for our film. Most of them couldn't talk about it. One guy we actually, he said, oh yeah, I can talk about it. First question, tears.
Wow.
He was gone. And as you see, a lot of these guys, it's so fascinating, are on the edge of telling you incredible stuff, and you're mesmerized. I mean, I was screening the film early on, and a woman said to me, it's horrible. Don't take out a single dead body. I thought that was really good, you know, that it was something you had to – one of my daughters, now 21, she was terrified of the vacuum cleaner when she was like one and two. She would run from the room screaming. And one day, the vacuum cleaner's going. My wife has the vacuum cleaner. And she just walks in and sits down on the vacuum cleaner. And that's the way she abolished her fear. And every once in a while,
I still have the fear of vacuum cleaners. Maybe I should try that.
Oh, that really sucks.
No joke. It goes right through me. That's our music, Ken. We've run out of time, but this was a very interesting hour.
I knew having Ken on would be great. I've been a huge fan, if you may allow me to gloat a little bit and kiss your ass a little bit. I've just been a fan for years, and it's a pleasure have you on the show.
Been great. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
So it's the war, it's the book, it's the CD, it's the DVD. In stores now, and you're doing a signing here in New York at the Time Warner Center in Columbus Circle, The Borders, this Wednesday at 7 p.m., and then downtown McNally, Robinson Booksellers at 52 Prince Street this Friday at 7 o'clock, right? And you're working on
National Parks, update on the baseball series, history of Prohibition, Vietnam, we're going to start working on.
Oh, wow.
You're insane. And Jeffrey Ross, we're going to have Jeffrey Ross back soon.
Jeffrey. Sorry, man. You know, come on. It's Ken Burns, for God's sake.
Hello?
Talking to your banana.
All right. Ken Burns, thank you so much.
And you know what, Jeff? The least you could have done while you were here is plug my New Year's Eve show at the North Fork Theater. What? That's what Jeff could have done.
Oh, no. Whore.
What? What? I was trying to help Jeff out.
I'm going
to
be there.
Jeffrey Ross will be at the Stress Factory December 5th in New Brunswick, New Jersey. We got to get out of here. We'll see you guys tomorrow. Thanks for listening.